All right, welcome everyone to the Ford Hall Forum at Suffolk University. I'm Jennifer Bernardi, the Executive Director of the Ford Hall Forum, where the speakers enlighten the audience and the audience challenges the speakers. Thank you so much for joining us tonight at our forum, Politics and Pasta, with Buddy Cianci. Before we begin, I'd like to thank the forum's generous sponsors, including Altria, the Lowell Institute, the Massachusetts Cultural Council, and the sponsors of our fantastic First Amendment Award that happened a few weeks ago, including Choate Hall and Stewart, Plymouth Rock, Prince Lobel, Ropes and Gray, Wilmer Hale, and WBUR. We especially want to thank our partner, Suffolk University, which provides the Ford Hall Forum with access to countless services. And we also thank our members here in the first few rows. Without you, we could not put this on. I'd like to introduce the Ford Hall Forum Chair of the Board and our moderator for this evening, Dominick Ianno. Dominick is the Chair of the Ford Hall Forum and the Director of Public Affairs, U.S. Northeast, in Pfizer's Global Sites Public Affairs Group. He began his Pfizer career in January of 2008, joining the company in a newly created position as Director of Public Affairs in Worldwide Public Affairs and Policy. Prior to joining Pfizer, Ianno served 4 years as Vice President at Gray Media in Boston, providing political and business counsel to a wide range of businesses, education, and political clients. He is a past executive director of the Massachusetts Republican Party and worked as a research and media operative for several statewide Republican campaigns in Massachusetts. A constant presence in Massachusetts business and political circles since the 90s, Ianno was named one of Politics and Campaign's, quote, top 100 Massachusetts influencers, unquote, in June 2010. A native of Hartford, New Hartford, New York, he holds a BA in political science from SUNY Oswego and a JD from the New England School of Law. Please, everyone, join me in welcoming Dominick Ianno.
How's this? Whoa, sorry. Thank you very much, Jen. I know you didn't all come here to see me, so I'll have a chance to introduce our speaker in a second. I'll just go through the format of tonight's program with you quickly. We're very honored to have Mayor Buddy Cianci here tonight to speak about his book, Pasta and Politics. The format tonight is very simple. We're gonna have a little conversation up here for a bit. I'll ask him some questions, but in the true tradition of the forum, everybody will has an opportunity to participate. So there's two microphones on each side at the front of the aisles here. So about halfway through the program, I'll turn it over to you, the audience, so you'll have an opportunity as well to engage in conversation, challenge, ask, praise, whatever you'd like. It's an open forum. So Mayor Cianci, Buddy, doesn't really need an introduction to most people. I think if you're here, you know who he is and his storied career. He recently wrote a book, which is, I believe, on sale, and he'll sign afterwards, Politics and Pasta. I have to read the subtitle because, of course, How I Prosecuted Mobsters, Rebuilt a Dying City, Dined with Sinatra, Spent 5 years in a federally funded gated community, and lived to tell the tale. Mayor Cianci was elected mayor of Providence in 1974 for the first time, was re-elected a few times, took a little bit of a break, which we could get into, was re-elected again in 1990 and served through 2002 when he took another break. He's never lost a mayoral election. He had some flirtations with other offices, I think, but we're very happy to have him. Mayor, I'm going to start first to ask you, why the book and why now?
Well, first of all, let me thank you for inviting me. This is one of the few free speeches I've given in the past few years.
We appreciate it.
They called me and they asked me, do you believe in free speech? I said, of course. They said, well, you're giving one. The publisher in New York called me. So at any rate, why did I write the book? Well, I'm not on the front nine anymore. I'm on the back nine. And I have a lot of interesting anecdotes and a storied career, ups, downs. It's a story of perseverance. And I felt that I wanted to put the things in writing that, not in rebuttal, it's not a rebuttal against another book that was written about me, but you know, the times of the 70s and 80s in the Northeast was a real exciting time to be mayor. And it was an exciting time because there was a tremendous amount of change going on. I look at my mayoralties as covering three different periods. The first period was being a social worker, because, you know, we all know the story of the American city. Back in the 60s, when the roads were built, 95, 195, everybody emptied the cities, went to the suburbs. The federal government picked up every kind of mortgage, you know, the FHA, the veterans, everything, and cities emptied out. And who was left in the cities were people who were minorities and people who were getting on in age, the elderly. And of course, there were a few stable neighborhoods, and things were changing. And I decided to run for mayor as a Republican in those days. That was like being in Providence. That was like being the Ayatollah Khomeini at the American Legion Convention, you know? But I was a prosecutor before I prosecuted organized crime. Let's see, we're taping this tonight, right?
Yep.
Well, I used to be in charge of the organized crime division for the Attorney General, and my entertainment was I would listen to the wiretaps at night. And one interesting story that's in the book, there was a bookmaking operation going on, and so I was listening to the tapes, and this one woman is saying to the other woman, "Do you know, my boyfriend said that these phones might be tapped." And she said, "Don't worry, my boyfriend told me what to say if the cops come." The other one said, "What's that?" And she said, "My boyfriend told me to plead the fifth commandment." So I had a lot of fun doing that. Prosecuted organized crime, prosecuted Raymond Patriarca back in the days of the 70s. And I tried a lot of cases for the Round State Police. And then I decided to run for mayor because I loved the city and there was an opportunity. Don't ever believe politicians don't have egos. They all have egos. And they run because of, you know, the ascension to power and the good works that you think you can do. And I saw the Democratic Party fighting. It was a machine that was in office. They were fighting, and I knew that whoever, in fact, my first ad was, "You may not know who Buddy Cianci is, but by November, he's going to look mighty good to you." And that was when the Democrats were fighting. So I just went in and took over. And people say, "Oh, you won because you were Italian." And I said, "Really? I didn't carry one Italian ward in the city of Providence. I was a Republican. But I carried the very liberal east side, where Brown University is, and the minority areas, because the city was in desperate shape. You could have rolled a bowling ball down the middle of Westminster Street, you wouldn't hit a soul. In fact, the Bible Society even moved out of town. That's how bad it was." So they took a chance on me. And so I decided to write those stories, you know, about how it all happened. And interesting stories. In those days, political correctness was taking care of the people who helped you. It wasn't like it is today. I'll never forget the first day I was in office. It's depicted in the book. I knew that, you know, the mayor's office in Providence is a very opulent place. You can tell it was definitely built by the executive branch of government. It has a beautiful high ceilings, and it has a dining room, and it has oriental rugs and a fireplace and leather walls. It overlooks the city. It's pretty heady when you're 32 years old to have all that happen. And there's a policeman who stands there with the big boots on. And I'll never forget the first day in office. How do you be mayor? I don't know how to be mayor. In fact, if I knew then or now what I knew then, I would never have voted for myself. I didn't know how to be mayor. So I'll never forget standing in the office or sitting in the office, and the policeman said, "Oh, your first appointment is here." And I thought I was going to meet some world leader. I thought I was going to meet some Menachem Begin or somebody, you know, or Golda Meir, somebody. And who walked in but a guy, a big, heavy-set guy, and he was a Democratic ward chairman of an area called Silver Lake in Providence. And Silver Lake, there's no water there. There's no yacht club. It's a teeming tenement district. And he was a Democrat, and he supported me. So he came in, and I knew that, you know, I wasn't naive. I knew he was there looking for something. But what troubled me, not troubled me, but what I was wondering, was he was followed by a little midget, a little man, about that big. So he sat down, he was big, he sat in the red chairs like this one in front of the desk, and he said to me, "You know, Mayor, if it weren't for me, you wouldn't have won." I said, "That's probably true." He said, "Now I got to get a few things." And I said, "Well, I understand that." He said, "See him." And I looked over and I said, "There was no political correctness in that day." I said, "Well, barely, I can see him." He put his two legs under the chair, you know, and he put his legs underneath him, and he kind of looked over the desk. And he said, "He's going to make a buck and a half a week." And I said, "That was pretty good money back in the 70s. And I said, to do what? He said, I don't care, make him an inkwell on your desk. So I said, so anyway, he got hired and he stayed with the city for 25 years. Now Arthur had died. 25 years later, now he was obviously disabled when he got hired. So he comes in and he says, Mayor, they're not giving me my pension. I said, what are you talking about? He crawled up in the same chair. And I said, of course they're giving you pension. He said, no, my disability pension. And I looked at him bemused, like a St. Bernard, kind of confused. I said, disability pension, that's why we hired you, because you were disabled, right? Now you want to collect a disability pension because of it. But there's a lot of stories in the book. You wonder why pensions are unsustainable these days, right? So, but there were a lot of stories that go into my mayoralty. But we were social workers, because it wasn't a question of whether you were going to have fireworks on the 4th of July. It was a question if you had enough fire trucks to put the fires out that they'd set, because we were going through voluntary desegregation in those days, and there was a lot of trouble. And basically, that's why I wrote the book, to depict those stories. That are true, and what you need to do to govern a city when you're a minority, a Republican, going with Democrats, in political parties today are not what they used to be. Political parties were, in those days, were totally different. Political parties was, you know, the chicken and the turkeys for Christmas, and everything had to go through a ward committee and all that. I didn't believe in that, and so I went above the fray of all that, because I didn't have a political party anyway. And what is a political party but a group of people who just are their purpose is to take over the control of the government by nonviolent means. That's what their purpose of the political party is, isn't it? That's what it is. And so I went to the people. They say I would go to the opening of an envelope, and I went everywhere. The opening of a wound I'd go to, you know. And so I got popular and was able to rise above that. That was the first phase of the mayoralty, social worker, and helping and trying to build community centers and deliver those services. The second part of the mayoralty was being a risk taker. And I don't know if you've been to Providence, but there were these railroad tracks that kind of went right through the city. And so we decided to take those out. And we took them out because they separated the city. We realized we had three rivers that we had the largest bridge in the world by Guinness Book of Records, and so we said, let's uncover the bridges and redirect the rivers to bring water in the city. And we did that, and we opened up tremendous land masses and also made the city a lot more attractive. And that was being risked, but then we had to be entrepreneurs, and we had to build buildings on those tracts of land. And so we built the Providence Place Mall, and we had to get Nordstrom's to come in, and Boston was competing with us, and it was a lot of fun, but I've answered that too long. So social worker, risk taker, entrepreneur. We became, people say, well, how did you get Nordstrom to come to the city of Providence? We built them the store. That's how we did it. I mean, there's no secret to that. I mean, so.
So I mean, I know Providence. First of all, you ran as an anti-corruption.
That's correct.
Mayor, and a Republican in 1974, which a Republican in 1974. Mm. Yeah, you're right.
Watergate year.
But talk about Providence when you took it over, the city, and today, because I look around Providence and I see, you know, you mentioned a lot of these stories in the book, from the mall to the skating rink to theater district.
Yeah, you know, more. All the vision in the world without action is a daydream. But all the action in the world without vision is a nightmare. So what I felt I needed to do was put together a coalition of people. First of all, I had to have an open government where people were involved in the planning process, or at least thought they were involved in the planning process. And then so what we tried to do was use different tools. I never let anybody knock a building down, because I always thought that the future of our city had a lot to do with our past. And in those days, the big theory was to knock everything down. And I don't want to badmouth any cities, but I'll just give you their initials, Hartford and New Haven. they tore everything down that they could possibly tear down. I wouldn't let them do that. And as a result, we tried to use some tools in the economic toolbox. We tried to use historic preservation. We tried to use the arts in order to reinvigorate our economy and reinvigorate our city. And we were leaders in historic preservation. I mean, we had 25% tax credits, accelerated depreciations, Historic District Commission, you could donate your facade to your house or the facade of your building to the Historic Preservation Commission, and you could get a tax deduction for that, but you never could change the facade anymore. Then we had loan programs, and then we did like 65 buildings in the down city. And then we decided that I felt that the arts were so important, because we had Rhode Island School of Design, we had a tremendous culturally, I think, distinguished in the population when it came to the arts, and we never took advantage of it. And so one of the things I did was create an arts district. But you say, oh, so anybody can do that. But we did it the first in the country where an artist could live in that district and work in that district and not pay any sales taxes on what they produced or any income taxes to the state. And that is what really took off, because a lot of artists, now, what artist do you know pays taxes? So, but it was really a very nice thing to do, right? But the governor vetoed the legislation, and that's how I ended up getting license plate number one. I'll tell you the story.
We'd love to hear it.
Yeah, the governor didn't like me, and he didn't like me because he wasn't a great speaker, and every time I'd speak, I'd have to go after him, and I would always thank him for warming up the crowd, you know. And anyway, what happened with that, we had been involved in creating this arts district, and I was driving through the Public Works Department one day, and the mayor of Providence always has a number on his car, 10,000, and the mayor of the second largest city has 20,000, and I had had that plate for 15 years, and I was getting kind of tired of it. So I drove through the Public Works Department one day, and I saw number one on a city car, and I said, how did that number get there? What's that car number? And he said, well, it belongs to the city. It's been here since Henry Ford invented the automobile. So I said, well, take that plate off and put it on my car. So they did, and then they put shields on it, and the governor, it looked just like the governor's plate, number one. So the governor got all mad. I love to play these games, because you should never make mayoralty boring. You should always have something to do that's fun. And so the governor got all mad at that, but he said, had the state police call me and say, take that plate off the car. I said, no, I don't have to, because we've had that plate in the city for years. Anyway, I took it off, but I called the Speaker of the House, and I called the head of the Senate. And I said, you know, I need a bill passed to give the mayor of Providence number one. And they said, oh, you're a distinguished mayor. We'd do that. They hated the governor. So so they passed it. And there's only two pieces of legislation that the governor vetoed that year. The arts district and my license plate. So it was a hot summer day, and we were partnering with the Smithsonian to bring them in to be partners with the city. And we had a ribbon cutting that morning. And it was the morning they were coming back, the legislature, to either override the veto or to confirm his, you know, or sustain his veto. And so we were there that morning. He was all mad at me, and he said, oh, I don't want you having that plate because you speed. I said, I don't drive. The policeman drives. So they went there. It was a hot day. And I'll never forget watching it on Capitol TV. And they came in. The State House in Rhode Island was not air conditioned. It had to be 100 degrees. And they were in their shorts, the legislature. They came back, and one stood up and he said, Paul Crowley, who was a legislator, he stood up, he said, look, we normally give 15 minutes to each side. It's so hot. We know we're back here to override the governor's veto on the arts bill and also to give the mayor his license plate. So that's how we ended up. But funny stories like that are in the book.
They definitely are. There's plenty of them. Yeah. You know, you talk so much. I mean, I think everybody, if you know Providence last 30 years, you think of you with Providence and the mayor. But you go through the book, your biggest regret is not running for U.S. Senate in 1976. You had a flirtation with being an ambassador. You ran for governor. Can you picture yourself today in any of those positions?
Nah. I don't know if I could afford it. Number one, I did flirt with that. In 1975, President Ford asked me to go to Washington to meet with him, and I had never met him before, and so I'll never forget going in there. And it's a vivid memory, because the guy who was sitting in the waiting room, was a Saturday morning, was Henry Cabot Lodge. And so we had a nice chat with him, and I had a nice chat. He told me how he beat Mayor Curley for governor, or I think he was talking about that. And then the Secret Service guy came out. He was the ambassador to the Vatican at that time. So I was 30-something years old. He was getting on in years. And the Secret Service guy came out to get us. And so Henry Cabot Lodge got up to go into the room. And he says, no, he says, the president's going to see the mayor next. So I thought that was very disrespectful to Henry Cabot Lodge. But anyway, I went in to see the president. And we talked, and it was fine. And then it was later on that I got to be on a steering committee and all this kind of stuff. But I got elected in 74, and in 1976, Ford was running for president again. And so he asked me to go down to the White House because Senator Pastore was not resigning, he wasn't running again for office. And so I went into his office, and he and Bob Packwood, Senator Packwood was there, because Packwood at the time was head of the committee to get put together with senators to run for the senatorial committee. So I said, well, I've just been elected mayor, a year and a half ago. So, you can win and we'll get you the money and all this stuff. So there was talk about it. And John Chafee was, not the John Chafee we know and love today, passed on several years ago, but John Chafee had lost the governorship. John Chafee had lost the senatorship. And John Chafee had the most ignominious position of being Secretary of the Navy for the country. While he was the former senator or former governor of Rhode Island, and he had to Nixon announced the closing of all the naval bases in Rhode Island. And when he was asked about it, he said, I didn't know he was closing the naval bases, and he was Secretary of the Navy. So he wasn't wasn't really the kind of guy that we know now. I mean, he was like, he lost the senatorship, he lost the governorship, and he was Secretary of the Navy when the president closed all the naval bases. So he wasn't exactly high on the popularity scale. So I was thinking about running, and he came to my house and decided he wanted to run, and with tears in his eyes and all this stuff. And I was a young guy, and so I really didn't know if I could beat him in a Republican primary. But ironically, years later, his pollster at that time was Fred Steeper. I hired Fred Steeper later, and Fred Steeper told me he never would have gone on a primary against you. I said, now you tell me.
But the Senate, I mean, really, I can't see in the Senate.
No, I can't imagine it either. I watch that stuff on TV, and I see these 8 or 10 people sitting around a table and waiting for turns to ask somebody a question, and then I want to do something, get it done, But I guess it's a distinguished part of this, the most exclusive club you could be in. But then I remember being asked, I ran for governor. And I'll never forget going out to meet Ronald Reagan, and that was in 79, and John Sears took me there. Not the John Sears that you guys know from here, the other John Sears who ran Reagan's campaign. And we went out, and Mike Deaver was sitting there, in Wilshire Boulevard, and Reagan, I was not a conservative, and Reagan was, obviously. And so we had this talk, because I was going to run for governor, and I said to him, I'm really not as conservative as you are. And I love to get Reagan looked at me, and he said, well, Mayor, he said, what you see is what you get. And so then I left, and I went with Sears to the Polo Lounge, and I said, Watergate was fresh in my mind. I said, if a guy like me runs for governor, let's say I would lose, what does a guy, not me, but a guy like me, what could you expect to get out of all this, right? you could be like head of the GSA, you could have an ambassadorship, you could do this, that. So I said, does the governor know about this? He said, that's the best part of working with Ronald Reagan. He doesn't have to know. he said, fine. So I ran for governor and lost. And
the ambassadorship? So John Chafee comes back.
Yeah, I know. So now I get on a plane and I go down to see my friend Lynn Nofsinger, who is, because I wanted to go collect on what, I lost. And I wanted to get out of Providence. I'd been there a while. So I go into the executive office building where Lynn Nofsinger and his assistant, a little guy named Lee Atwater, was his assistant. And Lee Atwater was very nervous, and he had his shoes off. He was sitting on a couch taking pictures. Now, you walked into the executive office building to Lynn Nofsinger's office. His sign was Director of Political Operations. I told him, I guess I'm in the right place, right? And he had all pictures of Nixon on the wall. Now, Reagan was president, but all pictures of Nixon waving goodbye, V sign, all that kind of stuff. So, no matter, you have to be, don't say anything bad about Nixon was the message I got from that. So I walked in the meeting, and you don't go to those meetings without an agenda, and I knew Lynn, and I had seen him in Providence 2 weeks before. And I walked in. He was very disheveled. He was a nice guy, but he didn't have his jacket on. He had a round table, no desk, and he had his tie down. He looked at me and said, "Buddy, why do you want to be an ambassador?" And I looked at him and I said, "Lynn, because I want to learn a second language. Why do I want to be an ambassador?" So he sends me upstairs to see some lady in like a Lily Pulitzer dress. She pulls a map of the world out. And she says, "Everything that's red you can't have, because that's career and that's committed. Anything that's yellow, or yellow is committed, but anything that's green you can look at." I said, "Okay." It was like throwing a dot at the map of the world, right? So they picked Costa Rica. She picked it. She said, "That sounds good." So I said, "Okay." So went downstairs and they said, "What are you doing next Saturday?" I said, "Nothing." So they said, "Go to Andrews Air Force Base." So I go to Andrews Air Force Base. I get on this big United States of America plane. You can't do this today. You can't have any contact with the country that you are being proposed for. And so I go down to Costa Rica, San Jose, Costa Rica. I met the president. And all I remember is that his wife and his daughter chewed gum a lot. And I felt like John Wayne there, too. I got off the plane. Everybody was shorter than me, which I liked. It's like when I go to see my relatives in Italy, I know I'm in the right town because everybody looks like my aunt. But anyway, I go there. I meant like it, not like it. So I come back and I get a call. "How did you like it?" "Well, it's okay. Well, it's a little, you're not satisfied." "So no, it's like, how about the Dominican Republic?" So I said, "Okay." So the next Saturday, go down to Andrew Fields Force Base, go down to the Dominican Republic. I meet everybody there and come back. And so I get the call. They're going to appoint me. And so So I called President Ford, who wasn't president then, but I said, "What should I do, blah, blah, blah?" He said, "Well, you gotta get your senator, Chafee, who I stepped aside for." So I called him, and I said, and I thought it was very interesting because I called his cousin in, who was a real nice guy, who always wanted to be mayor of Providence, but never could be it. And so I said, "You know, I'm gonna be leaving, so I think you should put your oar in the water, and you can get an early start, and I'll support you and all this." I thought I was doing a good thing because they were blood relatives, right? So I called Chafee and I said I wanted to see him. So he said, "Okay, see me at the train station." He liked to take the train back and forth to Washington. So I met him. We sat in the back seat of my car and I said, "I'm going to need your help. President's going to appoint me, blah, blah, blah." And Senator Pell, by the way, was a Democrat, called me and said he was the head of the Foreign Relations Committee. He said, "I'll be happy to help you. I'll be your advocate and all this." That's why I love that man. But anyway, Chafee says, "I don't think you're ready for it." I said, it only took him 4 years to he had like amnesia, I think. So anyway, he said, "I don't think you're ready, and but someone will be in touch with you." And then there was, 2 days, 3 days later, the chairman of the Republican Party in Rhode Island comes to see me along with the chairman of the Republican National Party. And they, first time I was ever like extorted, I don't use that term, they asked me for $100,000. So I changed parties. I just got out of the party. I ran as an independent the next time and beat them. So that's why they didn't like me. But that's the story of the Senate race. So that never happened.
So talk.
And
about
that's in the book. And
that's all.
Anyway, the publishers. Let me tell you, they had like 14 lawyers to check that out.
Well, this is a good question. I mean, I read the book. It's 340 pages and. The Buddy Cianci story, I find it hard to believe you got it into 340 pages. So, like a good movie, what was left on the cutting floor? What's not in the book?
Well, what was the question again?
What'd you leave out?
A lot of things. That's for the next there's a lot of things. There's so many things you don't put in here that you really can. And I wrote it with a co-author, David Fisher, who is a good writer. But we spent a lot of time together talking, and he would take the tape recordings, and I would proof the chapters and all that kind of stuff. But you leave out an awful lot. But what's in there is really good. I love to talk, but a lot of labor stuff is left out of it. You just can't. A lot of interaction with the city council. There are funny stories about my relationship with labor unions, as an example. I'll never forget the time I got supported by the labor unions, not the first time, but the second time. And I'll never forget firing, we had like a little fiscal problem in the city in 1980, and we had four men on a garbage truck. Now, you can put two men in a spaceship and send them to the moon. You don't need four men on a garbage truck, right? So, but it was it was left over from the, you know, the past, the old Ward Heeler days. And it's amazing that it's like when you're in municipal politics, especially in the Northeast, the people in the labor unions and the city council, they think the law of primogeniture applies to like a job. Like a garbage man dies, well, his son is supposed to get the job. See? And then there's certain ethnic groups that are associated with. I never knew this. I was an assistant attorney general, right? So I decided that, you know, that we didn't need four men on a garbage truck. And so to show I was a good guy, so we'll make it three men on the garbage truck. And so they decided, they said, well, man, you can't do that. I said, yes, I can. And I had gone out to bid before that to get a private company, but I put the bid in my pocket. I didn't award it. But I had it in case I needed it for a private company. And so then I said to them, three men on a truck, and they implemented three men on a truck. And I said, to show you I'm not a hard-hearted guy, we used to pick the garbage up in the backyards. We'll have the citizens bring the garbage in the front. And in addition to that, we'll, instead of pick up garbage 5 days a week, we'll pick it up just twice a week, because it's only three men on the truck. Now, they still didn't like that. So what did they do? They ended up throwing the garbage all over the place. They just picked the garbage up and threw it all over the streets of Providence. I have 2 days, and so then I sent the cameras out to take pictures of them throwing the garbage on the streets. The place was a mess. And so I went down to the Public Works Department very bravely with about, I don't know, 110 policemen. right?
Just a few friends.
And told them that they were fired. And I told them that I don't care if Samuel Gompers was on the arbitration panel. With the film we had, they would never get, he couldn't hire him back. So anyway, we had a long discussion, and they said, give us our jobs back and we'll clean it up. I said, okay, you'll do that? I'll do that. So I said, but you have to go on probation. So the lawyers were there, they drafted up everything, and they, about 90 of them, they signed all these probation things, and they said, who's gonna be the judge? I said, the people will be the judge. So then I said, fine. Now they went and they picked all the garbage up, 3 minutes, they did a great job, they cleaned the whole city up. And then I went to the sewer department where they had a clause in their contract from before I was mayor where they had a 6-day guaranteed overtime, whether they worked or not, right? And so I went in there and these guys like dressed up like in tuxedos working in the sewer plant. I said, you know, there's no more 6-day guaranteed overtime. So they said, you get your lawyer, we'll get ours. And there's no lawyers. They said, there's no more 6-day guaranteed overtime. So they went on strike. Now the other guys who were dutifully picking the garbage up, they decided to join with their brothers. They went on strike, so I had to fire them, and I did. And I wrote in the other company, but I did put a fourth man on a truck. It was a policeman with a shotgun. but to keep them awake, because they were sabotaging the trucks and all that. But I'll tell you what I did, I never gave ammunition. They didn't ever do that until the book came out. No ammunition, because I'm afraid something crazy would happen. But anyway, that went on for a while, and my popularity started to go up. Because we were fighting, and I wasn't an anti-union guy. I was not an anti-union guy. And, but it was just getting too expensive, and no one likes people, they don't like people throwing garbage on their streets. So I ended up being an expert on privatization. This was, by the way, before Reagan fired the air traffic controllers. And so I got to be an expert on privatization. I don't know even what the word meant. I just fired garbage men, right, and put a private company in. And so I got invited to go to Windsor Castle to speak to the British government about privatization. I stayed at Windsor Castle. They had a big conference there, and it was beautiful. And the British government paid, and they published a book. Because Margaret Thatcher was then trying to privatize like British Air and all that, and they hadn't done it, but we did it in Providence. We saved a lot of money with privatization. That was a dirty word then. Now it's not a dirty word. But I remember that distinctively, and then I had to run for mayor again, and I'll never forget going to the union meeting where 6 or 8 months before I had put the shotguns on them, asking for their endorsement. That's temerity, right? Isn't it? But you got to b- bear with me here. I went into the meeting and they gave me like point applause. This was the whole AFL-CIO. And so there was a bearded lawyer named Raoul Lovett. He's since passed on. Nice guy. He's a very liberal, leftist kind of guy, but a good lawyer. And he said, you're not going to get the endorsement. I said, yeah, I know that. I said, but you know something? Let me tell you something. I said, I'll win without it. But I said, let me tell you. This morning, we had to send policemen to the Hospital Trust Bank, which is now Bank America, because you guys had put pickets there trying to stop people from making deposits in the bank. And the reason was they don't want this bank to get any money because they were supposedly anti-union. And they were anti-union because they had some members of their board, this bank, who were members of on the board of directors of a place called Brown and Shop, which had the longest strike in the world, in the country going, a machine shop. And they were all brothers and united and all this stuff. So they were trying to go after the bank. They had brought some expert in from Chicago, some labor guy who said, you have to go after the bank because they have the same board of directors. I said, that's stupid. Send the horses down. And they cleared out a path and everybody could put the money in. I said, but if you really want to get money, that's what your whole thing is about, isn't it? I said, I know how you could switch $300 or $400 million out of that bank. They said, how? I said, well, the pension money, they have $300 or $400 million. They're our agents for that money. So I said, why don't you just, if Thursday night, if I get sick, if I go bowling, you guys get the votes, because I'm on the board too, but if I don't show up, you've got the votes. And the finance director, they said, you can do that. I said, no, you can do it if I'm not there. And so they said, well, I said, no, but they said, you want the endorsement, don't you? I said, yeah. He said, well, I'll be right back. He comes back in 5 minutes and he says, Thursday night after we move the money, we're going to endorse you. I said, no, that ain't going to happen. I said, you're going to endorse me tonight. And then Thursday night, I won't be there. So the next, I left. The next morning, I pick up the Providence Journal, big headline. The journal to this day, when they read the book, they don't know how I got the endorsement after putting shotguns on them. It said, laborers endorse Cianci. And they started all this baloney about how it was great for the city because I built buildings and all this kind of stuff. We put shotguns on them earlier.
So I'm going to ask you one or two. I'm going to ask you one or two more questions, but yep. If people want to start lining up, we'll open it to the floor in a few minutes. I do want to talk about your 5-year federally funded housing.
Yes.
People really appreciate what you did for the city of Providence, obviously. But this happened. You were convicted of one count, right?
Out of 47, I think, original charges, that 20 reduced it to 27, and I was found. Eventually went to trial on 12 or 14, and was found not guilty of all but one. And I was found guilty of a charge conspiracy to commit a crime I was found not guilty of. That's true. Conspiracy to commit a crime I was found not guilty of. And I'd rather have the mob after me than the federal government, to be honest with you. You know, I mean, but if they come at you, they'll use every resource they possibly can. 1 year, they audited me, and they came in, and they, and I'm no angel, by the way, but they came in and they came in and they said, and you know what it is though? It's the myth. You should ask too about the divorce situation with the log and all this. Let me tell you something. John Kennedy once gave a speech at Yale. And he said, I can handle the lies, because I can always tell, I'm paraphrasing, I can handle the lies, but because I can always tell the truth. But it's the myth that goes on. You'll never erase that myth. Nobody ever hit anybody with a fireplace log.
This was your 1982.
Yeah, the first, picked up a log and threw it in the fireplace, but apparently I placed him in reasonable apprehension of bodily harm, so that became assault, so I left office. But if you listen to the stories, I mean, and you see the TV and everybody, it just keeps carrying on. When I was in law school, you know, they have 10 rows of students and 5 back, and the professor would say, he'd write on a piece of paper a story, and he'd tell the person in the first seat, Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. And he wouldn't give you the paper, but he'd say, now tell the guy behind you what I just told you. By the time it got to the 10th person in the back, Jack and Jill had a baby, they had a family, they had the whole thing. And that's what the myth is about that incident. The other incident was, you know, I surrounded myself. I was a mayor. I had 7,000, 8,000 people working in the city. And you have people who always say, the mayor knows. You know, I'd like to tell you how many people have gotten New Year's Eve reservations or tables at restaurants because they say they knew me or they I called for them or whatever. And I'm not erasing responsibility. Have I done things in office I shouldn't have done? Yeah, absolutely. Did I do the things, did I commit a RICO? Was I running a RICO operation, a racketeering influence corrupt practice? No, absolutely not. I did go to prison for 4.5 years. I don't recommend it. The warden is not exactly the cruise director on the QE2. It wasn't in his background. I didn't have any problems in prison. I found out if you go to prison, I'll never forget, when I came home, the Speaker of the House in Rhode Island asked me to speak at his St. Patrick's Day party. It was one of the first speeches I made when I came home. And it was at a big hall, and the editors of the Providence Journal were there, and TV, and all the legislation. And so I got up, and they were razzing me a little bit, and I got up, and the restaurant, the guy who owned the restaurant, the food, you know, he was jazzing me. And so I said, well, I had better food in the can than I had here, you know. Then I said, you know, I'm here to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day, but I have an ulterior motive too. I've just started a new business called Buddy Cianci Pre-Incarceration Counseling. And as I look out at this audience, I see a treasure trove of applicants, right? Right? Of business, right? But anyway, in prison, you can't let the time do you. You have to do the time. And what do I mean by that? You can't say to yourself every day, oh, where could I be? Could I be here? Could I be there? You know, you can't do that. You've got to do it every day. And I read 400 books when I was in prison. And I didn't have a great time. I took 50 pounds off, no booze, no cigarettes, no nothing. And they say, one day I'm sitting there outside, and one of the younger guys says to me, you know, see that guy over there? He just got 20 years. If that were me, I'd jump right off that building. I'd say, why would you do that? He'd say, I'd kill myself. I said, well, the easier way is to kill yourself in prison than jump off a building. He said, what are you talking about? I said, see in there, there was a Saturday morning. All the younger kids, you know, you know how you can tell how long a person's been in prison by the size of the earphones that they carry around. See, in prison, when you watch television, you don't listen to volume on the TV. You have a radio, and you have earphones that go into that radio, and you tune it to the frequency of the TV. There's 3 or 4 TVs up there. Whatever TV station it is, you just tune it to the frequency, and the audio comes through here. So if you've been there a while, you save your money, you can get bigger earphones, you see, bigger and bigger. So you see guys who've been there a while, big earphones. Guys who've been there for a little while, got little things like this in their ear, right? So I said, well, on Saturday mornings, these kids, mostly minority kids, they like to watch the BET, you know, the Black Entertainment Network. I said, if you want to kill yourself, don't jump off a building. Some Saturday morning, all these guys are watching the TV, can't hear anything, but they're, you know, watching, doing the music. I said, go and change the channel to the golf match. You'll kill yourself, right? But prison was, I never had a problem in prison. I met a lot of interesting people. I met a lot of people who were part of the organized criminal cartel, to be euphemistic. A lot of individuals who were, I didn't go to a camp. I went to a regular prison. And then when I had a chance to move, I didn't, because I would have lost my job in the library, which wasn't exactly tough. So I stayed there for the time being. And I came back, and I was surprised at the reception I got from everybody. And do I think that, was I guilty? No, I've always proclaimed my innocence. I never thought I was guilty, and I still to this day, I never took a dime in office, never took a penny. Did I raise money? Absolutely. Were there shady things? I'll tell you, I believe in, we built a great performing arts center in Providence, and it wasn't always that way. It was a decrepit theater. It was a beautiful theater, but I'll never forget, there were some people who called me early on in my mayoralty, and they said, Mayor, you know that B.A. Dario, he ran the racetracks, he owns that theater, he wants to tear it down. They said, do you know him? I said, well, yeah, I don't know him, but I know who he is. So why are you asking me to call him? So because you're Italian, and he's Italian, real sensitive guys, these guys, right? So I said, I'll call him. So I called him, I said, I'd like to see you, Mr. Dario, because he owned the building that they wanted to tear down, this beautiful theater. It was a little bit tattered, but it was a beautiful theater. And so I went to his house and I tried to convince him. I gave him a great soliloquy as to why he shouldn't tear the theater down. This is when the city was in dire straits. So he wouldn't listen. I finally convinced him to come to my office. And the people who wanted to buy the theater were Textron and Providence Journal and those people. So I could never put this guy in the same room with them. Never in a million years. And he hated them. They hated him. So we finally negotiated a price and the city would participate. So at the end of the deal, I'm in my office with him and the other guys are in the other office. And Dario, this guy, says to me, what about my other $40,000? I said, what $40,000? He said, they promised me $1,000 a day to negotiate. So I picked up the phone and I called the head of Textron, Bill Miller, and who eventually became Secretary of the Treasury. I said, Bill, this Dario, he wants his other $40,000 that we forgot to talk about. I never heard him swear. I heard him swear that, that's baloney, but that didn't happen. I said, forget, I don't want to blow the deal. Forget it, I'll handle it. So I said to Dario, they're not going to pay the $40,000. He said, see, the deal's off. I said, wait a minute, what if I can help you? I said, what if I can give you $20,000? He said, how can you do that? I said, I'll make you, this is the racetrack owner, I said, I'll make you the city consultant on the arts, right? He said, make it a 25. I said, okay. Now see, that's what I should have gone to jail for. So, but anyway, that theater now has become one of the finest performing arts theaters in the country, and the reason it is because we've put a lot of money in it, but that's a non-profit, supposedly a proud performing arts center, but we allow the people who run it to have a for-profit operation that manage about 10 other theaters around the country. That's why we get all the stuff first, because if they don't go to us, they don't go there.
So I'm gonna, we're about halfway through the program.
Yeah, whatever you want.
Open it up. I mean, I'm sure some people in the audience have questions, comments, stories of your own.
Yes, sir.
We'll start over here on the left.
Yep.
Thank you so much for coming and sharing your experiences. Politics really should be fun, at least local politics, and thank you for saying that. And I just wish you might have been born in Boston. Maybe you would have been our mayor at some point.
You've got a good mayor here. You've got good mayors. Ray Flynn's a good friend of mine.
Fun. We're talking about fun.
I like to go to church all the time.
My question is about your attorney. You must have known lots of lawyers. I was curious about your process of selection. Somebody from Boston, did you get along? How did it work? I know from practicing in Rhode Island that they don't like Boston attorneys, and I wonder,
I don't like any attorneys. I do. I love attorneys. I'm only kidding. How did I select the lawyer? I selected an attorney because I had a long-standing relationship with Richard Egbert.
Yes, the late, he's great passed Richard Egbert. He's a wonderful man.
I started to hear the little things about investigations. I called him and he was gutsy. And I'll tell you why I selected him, because he doesn't plead anybody. And I wasn't ever going to plead guilty because I wasn't. We had all kinds of deals. They offered to do this, do that. We'll throw out all this stuff. But I wasn't guilty. And so I wasn't going to say that I was. Now, did I have people around me? Yeah. Could you say that we had incidents where you could maybe assume that I was part of something, but I wasn't. And I told that to Egbert. Egbert believed me. And it's funny because when the only guilty came in, which was on the conspiracy, he said, if I had known that, he said, I would have tried a whole different case. They had tapes. They never had recorded me on anything. I'll tell you one of the things that Richard and I disagreed on. He was a great lawyer. But not that we didn't agree. I think that perhaps the government, and I'm not so sure the judge made the right ruling. There was one time that they taped me, and it was a time when they had set me up to have dinner with an undercover agent. They had nothing on me, but they got a maitre d' in a restaurant in Providence to keep asking me if I'd have dinner with this out-of-town businessman for about 4 months. I finally said I would for lunch. And the guy masqueraded himself as an air conditioning executive, a heating and air conditioning. So we had lunch, and he was telling me that he could fix all the schools in the city for no charge to the city, just on what the energy cost that would save. They refit all the energy, the boilers, and all that kind of stuff. and we wouldn't have to pay anything, just what they, just he would make it off the energy savings, and then we would recapture those savings over the years. So then he said to me, now who do I have to see to get that done? I said, well, you have to probably go to the director of public property. And he said, well, you know, how do I take care of him? And I said, if you take care of anybody in my administration, I can't say here what I said then, I would perform a certain surgery on his very important parts of his body. So when I said, don't you, if that ever happens, I said, I'll cut something off and I will also have him arrested. That was all on the FBI tape. We tried to introduce it, which would have been very exculpatory, and they wouldn't let it in evidence. And that was the one thing. And you know, you go to, you have a trial of your, a jury of your peers. There was one person from Providence on my jury. There was one. She came from Houston, Texas. She lived in the city about a year. Wow. There's not one. And they were all, you know. And you know, you get intimidated. You know, the jurors come in and they're led around by the sheriff, by the marshals, and those big opulent buildings, and you know, it's all this. I was an assistant attorney general, and let me tell you, the first thing a grand juror should do, if you're on a grand jury, is throw the prosecutor out. Say, you work for me. The prosecutor doesn't, you don't, the grand jury doesn't work for the prosecutor. The prosecutor will gear evidence all the way he wants it to go, not put stuff in that's doesn't have to. But, and juries are intimidated by prosecutors. They really are. And at least that's the way I found it, because I used to use that tactic when I was assistant attorney general.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The question over here to the right.
I was watching the Rhode Island PBS channel. I think it was Olneyville was the black section in Providence, and how they ease out the blacks out of Providence after many years of faithful. They've been very good in the community, and they've made parking garages. They did everything else.
Olneyville.
When you were in office then?
Olneyville is not a black.
Not Olneyville. Well, what was the black section?
South Providence was black.
That was the name for it. The black section. It had been there for years.
Well, I never paid attention to race, so I don't know.
I just wondered if you were in office when that happened.
When what happened?
When they eased out the black section, they eased them out with political deals. And
the only people who ever were displaced in the city was the area of Fox Point.
That must be it.
Yeah, and they were mostly Portuguese.
That's it.
They were Portuguese. That was long before.
I'm sorry.
There's a... Yeah. There were Portuguese population.
Right.
And you're right. That happened when Route 95 was being constructed in the 50s,
That's
60s.
Right.
And what occurred was they displaced that whole neighborhood because of Route 95 that went through. And, you know, I guess...
It was very sad.
Well, it was sad because that population, which is still... They moved to other parts of the city. They moved and they strengthened... They actually strengthened... the Elmwood section of the city, that's where a lot of them move. But there's still a lot of poor, but that's the Brown University area.
Right.
Basically, Brown, Rhode Island School of Design, and it's a real upscale area now, really upscale. Well, that's the gentrification, I mean, that's what happened there.
Right.
You know, Providence is a city that is very diverse. I used to ride around, and I could close my eyes, and I could tell you what neighborhood I was in by smelling the food. You know, I could figure that out. And Providence is also a very, I always believed in branding a city, and I remember when we brought the hockey team and they wanted to make it the Providence Jewelers, you know, and we made a deal with Harry Sinden to bring the Providence Bruins in. And I said, we can't do that. Can you imagine the headlines in the paper if we lose, Jews lose, you know? you know, we can't have that. So we got to have, so we wanted to use the Bruin name, and so we got that. And then they wanted to name the Performing Arts Center the Ocean State. I said, no, the state gave you no money, so we made it the Providence Performing Arts Center. And I gave him the last check, which I don't know, about $1 million. I said, you got to change the name of the theater to Providence Performing Arts Center if you're gonna get the money. And so they did, and they have to, if they ever change the name back, they have to give the city $7 million. They'll never see that name change. And then the other thing is, like, I love the horses, because they brand the city. We brought the Mounted Command back. And because, you know, I love horses, and you never see anybody pet a police car. They pet a horse, right? And also the gondolas that traverse up and down the Providence River. All that is part of branding. And the ballet that we brought in, that's Providence Ballet. And I always believed in that. Providence, the Providence Mall was supposed to be the Capital Center Mall. Providence Mall, and that's one of the things. In restaurants, we got in the convention and destination business. And one of the reasons we found that that you had to do the right thing for conventioners. They needed restaurants. And the last person that a banker wants to see is a restaurateur. Ever see a guy who owns a restaurant try to go to a bank and say, I want to open a restaurant? That doesn't happen. So we created a bank for restaurants with our community development money. And we loan money out to bankers or to restaurateurs for 1%. That's where you have a great restaurant image in the city of Providence. We loaned money out to about 80 restaurants at 1%.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
It's a question over here.
Yes, sir.
Well, good evening.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned that you prosecuted Raymond Patriaca.
Twice.
Well, there was a time when our own Whitey Bulger, who later turned out to be an FBI informant, yep. was in cahoots with Patriaca with some of his, his action. Now, did you have any contact with him or either inside or outside the court?
No, I was a young prosecutor, but I worked on the case with a prosecutor named Irving Brodsky. And the case involved the murder of a couple of people in that Silver Lake neighborhood I talked about earlier. And the witness was Red Kelly. He was a witness who changed over from being a mafia type guy to us. And I used to meet with him, and he planned the murder of those two guys with Patriaca at a place called the Gaslight Restaurant. And so in those days, when you tried cases, you didn't have the benefit of discovery. Today, if you try a case, you have to give all the reports over then, well, who your witnesses are going to be. In those days, it was like Perry Mason. They would bring, you didn't have discovery, right? So we rested our case, we proved it all, and with this Red Kelly. And the next thing I know, the defense calls their first witness, and the first witness is a priest with a collar. His name is Father Raymond Moriarty. He takes the seat, hugs Patriaca, and then he gets on the stand, what's your name? Father Raymond Moriarty, where are you from? Oxon Hill, Maryland. What do you do? I'm the pastor of St. Timothy's Church. Where were you on that day, the day that Patriaca was supposed to be planning? Oh, I was with Mr. Patriaca. Where? Oh, why? Well, his wife had died, and I came up to go visit the gravestone at the Gate of Heaven Cemetery, and I blessed the stone. And we stayed at his house. Well, the 12 Catholics on the jury crossed, making the sign of the cross. So I said, I think we needed to be calling the church down in Maryland, and they would hang up on me. So I called, our bishop had died, and there was a coadjutor of the diocese there, Bishop Angel. I called him. I told him a story. I said, I can't get any response down in Maryland. So he said, you wait there. About 15 minutes later, a Monsignor called me from the FBI. Can you believe that? He was like maybe the chaplain or something. I don't know what the hell he was, but he was connected. So I flew down there and went into the church with the Monsignor, and they gave us the records. And there was the priest on that day that he was supposed to be with Patriaca baptizing a baby in the church with the date and everything. So I don't know what possessed me. I had marshals with me. I said, let's go to the house where this family is that has that had the baby baptized. I walked there, and who's on the porch but Raymond's son, Raymond Patriaca's son, yeah. And Joey One-Arm, a guy from the neighborhood, right? And so I said, get off the porch. And so we ended up taking taking them back with us, and I had to go see. Now, the priest now had left the state of Rhode Island on his own. He wasn't supposed to leave, but we didn't have a subpoena. It was a defense witness. So he went back to Maryland. So the attorney general tells me, he says, well, you better go bring, you got to bring him back. He left. So I went to see the cardinals, went to the cardinal's office and Cardinal O'Boyle. And he said, so they had this law firm like Rock and Stone, I forget who they were. And they said, well, you don't have any subpoenas, you don't have any compact with Maryland. But so I said to the attorney general, actually deputy attorney general, Al DeRobio, who's now dead, but he was then became head of the court, the superior court. He said to me, you got the detectives with you? I said, yeah, I got two of them. He said, well, take that priest. He said, I said, they won't let him come back. He said, they got handcuffs, those cops? I said, yeah, they got handcuffs. He said, well, handcuff them, handcuff the priest to Stephen so the detectives arm and bring him back. I said, but that would be kidnapping. He said, yeah, in maybe 4 or 5 years, the Supreme Court will tell us that, right? But right now, bring him back. So I said, no, I'm going to do that. So we ended up getting him to voluntarily come back, and the rest of this history. But that story's in the book. It's a funny story.
So part of your subtitle is when you dined with Sinatra, and there's a story where that came back up, right?
Yeah. Sinatra was a, I was going out to California. It was one of my visits to President Ford. My father was a doctor, and he had passed on during by this time. But he had a friend who was a doctor in California, and so that doctor knew some people I knew. So they said, why don't you call the doctor when you get out to California after you see Ford, and maybe you can have dinner with him or something. So I called out of respect, and I didn't want to really spend any time with him. If you're watching this, doctor, I didn't really mean that. But anyway, I said, there was an airline strike. I've got to get back. And, you know, I don't know, they could call me anytime. He said, oh, I just wanted you to have dinner with Sinatra tonight at his house. I said, I'm not doing a thing. I'm not. Right? So I go to the house, and Barbara Marx answers the door. And ironically, so I wear a shirt and tie like a dumbbell. And so I go there, and I'm sitting down. Finally, I call my office. I said, you know, anything going on? And they said, yeah, there was a judge used to always use one of my cars when I left town. And he said, Dr. DeBakey used your car to go to the airport with the judge. I said, oh, okay, let the cop take him, fine. He said the cops were complaining because they left these hoagie sandwiches and they stunk in the back seat of the car. I said, oh, okay. What else? Nothing. Okay. I was waiting there by the bar. Who comes out? Sinatra. He says, I want to introduce you to, he says hello. He says, I want to introduce you to Dr. DeBakey, right? I said, you just used my car. I said, you sunk it all up. Anyway, Sinatra, we got to be, but then he would call me. But he would call me on the strangest things. He would call me, one day he called me, it was September, right around Labor Day. He was in Atlantic City doing a show. So the phone rings, and I had a substitute secretary in there because it was around a holiday, and Rosemary, her name was, and she came like once every month or so. So I'm in my office, and she rings me, and she says, there's some nut on the phone who says he's Frank Sinatra. No, it's gotta be him, right? So I pick up the phone, and he says, I just saw your picture in Town and Country magazine. They had done a story about the city, and I was in a picture with Howard Swearer, who was the president of Brown at the time. They were talking about historic restoration of the city hall and all that. And there were pictures. And so he said, I just saw your picture with this guy who's the president of Brown. I said, he said, you know him good? I said, yeah, I know him. He said, well, my mother's doctor's kid applied there and didn't make it. He said, now, can you talk to him? He said, and call Dorothy back when my shows are, I'm doing two shows, he said. And he said, call in between the shows. I said, let me understand this. You want me, it's like he already got rejected, and you want me to call the president of Brown, you want me to get this kid into school all before you start your second show, right? So he said, yeah, you can handle that, can't you? So I called Brown, he wasn't there, so I asked the security detail to call the Brown security, and they found him, he's playing tennis. So I said, I gotta talk to you. So Sinatra had been in town a few weeks before, and I gave him a fire hat, and it was in the paper. So I went up to see Swearer, and he had the director of admissions with him, a guy named Jim Rogers. And so explained the situation. And so Rogers looks at me, he says, didn't I see your picture in the paper with him? You were giving him a gun to the city or something, right? So they got off to a bad start. So I said, what are you doing here? Aren't you, it's 5 o'clock. Aren't you normally walking your rat around the seaside at this time, right? He ended up going to an Ivy League school. Let me put it that. There was another incident. I don't know if I should tell. Well, it's in the book.
we'll go through. Okay.
Go ahead.
Hello there. Hi. I just wanted to ask what it was that made you run as a Republican in 1974 when you said you were as popular as what Ayatollah at an American Legion convention.
Go ahead.
And then the other question I just want to know about is what do you think about the fact that Seth MacFarlane makes fun of you constantly on Family Guy? MacFarlane, the creator of Family Guy, he's always making fun of you.
Am I on that show, Family Guy? I don't get paid for that. You know. But I don't see it much. But I understand it's Buddy Cianci High School or something?
Yeah. Junior High.
Junior High? Yeah. That's Seth MacFarlane.
Yeah.
They make fun of me on the show?
Constantly. But it's funny. I just wonder what you thought of it.
Yeah, but I've only seen it once, you know, flipping through channels. But Seth MacFarlane went to Rhode Island School of Design. And I was on the board of Rhode Island School of Design for 20 years. And And I don't know why he does. I guess I always was very popular with the kids at RISD. Every graduation, like this is the graduation time, I used to get up and I used to relieve them of all their parking tickets and stuff. And the judges used to go crazy. And they go, whoa, the mayor said I didn't have to pay. The last year I was in office, though, I said to them, I said, I don't know if I can do it this year. Things are getting a little hot, you know. But your first question, why I ran as a Republican. Actually, the Democratic Party in the city of Providence back in the 60s and 70s was a very conservative party. And the Republican Party was the more moderate party. And I was more moderate. And for instance, there were no blacks, there were no women, there were none of that stuff. Because they had, you know, the Democratic Party in those times was really being crushed by the weight of its own existence. It was corrupt. It was not inclusive. It was exclusive, and frankly, there was a big Democratic primary going on, and I had no name recognition. I thought, let them beat their brains out, and I'll try to win as a Republican. And then I changed parties to an independent later on. But I don't know why Seth MacFarlane does. I should ask him. I should have my civil lawyer call him and say, where's my friend? Thank you.
There's a question over here.
Yes, sir.
Mayor, good evening. Thanks for coming up. I know you gave up an hour and a half of your radio show to be
here. Yes, I did.
A seven-year resident of Providence, I loved every minute. I was a graduate of Providence College in 2001, and I could tell you some great stories, including how Frank Carenti backed into my car outside State Towing on Valley Street one day.
Oh, did he really? He backed himself into a lot of things.
But I'm assuming the governor you're talking about who vetoed your plate was Governor Allman, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, I remember as you were telling that story that, you know, one of my favorite Buddy Cianci quotes was, I carried Providence in the last election, he didn't, when you were talking about the stadium. Now, the New England Patriots Stadium was a hotly contested item all throughout Southern New England. I mean, right. Obviously Hartford and Providence. I'd like you to go back a little bit and tell your side of the story as to why Providence wasn't the proper site, because that Harris Avenue area really hasn't come back at all. I mean, there's some apartments down there in the Foundry, but other states, other cities have proven that having a stadium and having some economic viability, retail around it, has been a winning model.
Okay, that's a fair question. I was all excited when the Speaker of the House and Kraft started arguing about the stadium in Boston here. And so we put our oar in to get the stadium. And I hired a pretty good team. I actually sent them to school at Marquette. They have a big sports school there. Sent them out there for a crash course. And then we approached the Krafts. And I have nothing but good things to say about Bob Kraft and his family. And they treated us with respect. And I think we would have had the stadium, but for the fact that the governor and I couldn't agree on it. Let me tell you, have any of you ever been to like a Polish or an Italian wedding? Okay. See, at the wedding, they take like the flower, the centerpiece, and at the end of the wedding, they'll say, the band leader will say sometimes, take the quarter out and pass it around as the music plays, and when the music stops, if you hold the quarter, you can take the flowers home. See, it's like dealing with a stadium. The centerpiece is the stadium. And then you're sitting with, in my case, Tagliabue, who is the commissioner of football, Kraft, who's the owner, the player agents, the governor, the mayor, and we start passing that quarter around, you see? And when the music stops, if you're holding the quarter, you own the stadium, okay? Now that's $800 million, all right? And they play 13 games a year, 14 games a year, whatever they might play with exhibitions and stuff. And it gets to be extremely expensive. And in addition to that, there were still more and more requirements. They wanted more land for practice fields. We had to condemn a whole neighborhood up in Smith Hill to give them what they wanted. And I was willing to do that. But you know, Richard Daley, who just retired as mayor of Chicago, I was mayor when his father was mayor, and mayor when he was mayor. He and I got to be pretty good colleagues and friends. And he once told me something, and I was mayor longer than, or before he was, but we're talking at a mayor's meeting one time. He said, I'd rather have a season of Monet than the Chicago Bears. That's what he said. It's in the book. And the reason that he said that was, think of what a stadium will do for you. A stadium will be occupied 13 or 14 days a year. How many times can you get Pavarotti to come in and sing for you, right, when he was living? You're going to be competing with your performing arts center, your civic center, and all this other kind of stuff for events. And there's some economic advantage. It's great, you know, Providence, the stadium, and the whole thing. But we get all the economic advantages in Providence of having that stadium as if it were in Providence. I'll tell you why. Whenever the visiting teams come in, they land at our airport and pay the landing fees. When they stay at the hotels, the visiting teams, they stay in our hotels in Providence, and they pay the room taxes. They eat in our hotels. All the media stay at the Westin Hotel, the Biltmore Hotel. So we get all the benefits, and we don't have to pay for the stadium. So when you think about it, we were close to getting it, but there was no cigar. And it was just out of the question. And then they started flirting with Hartford a little bit. And I told Bob Kraft, that's not, and he knew it. He knows more about football than I know, that's for sure. But that wasn't his market. That's a giant market. But Providence would have been a market for the Patriots. And you're right. I mean, it would have been nice to have, but we've done a lot of work making that area, well, with the mall, and making in the Foundry and 903, the big apartment house. That was a successful project. But it would have cost a lot of money, and the state wasn't willing to do it. See, how you got to finance things today, for instance, malls, we were the first city to do it. Use tax incremental financing. That's how one of the mall was built, and Corliss Landing. You're gonna be willing to take all the tax dollars that you get from that project and segregate it out of the general fund. And let's say that's $10 million or $15 million, whatever it is. That's your interest payment on the money you're gonna borrow over 20 or 30 years to finance the infrastructure that goes around it. So that's, with this deal, there was not a lot of taxes being paid by the Patriots.
Thank you.
And then you're gonna deal with when you buy a ticket to the Patriots or to any stadium, when you wanna buy a ticket, you don't buy a season ticket. You buy a licensing commitment. For instance, if you wanna sit in the 30-yard line, if you want a season ticket, you pay them X number of dollars for the license that gives you the right to buy the ticket. And they didn't wanna give any of that revenue up, which I don't blame them for.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Just a quick question. Since the conspiracy charge was a felony, is that why did you lose your whole pension?
Yes. Yeah. I had a pension that I haven't applied for it, let me put it that way, which is sending them nuts because I don't know what to do with it, about it. But I feel that, I put a lot of years and I put a lot of money in the pension system after taxes. And that money's just sitting there. Now, I guess I could claim that, but it's a very complicated legal process that's affecting other people. So I'll see how those cases end up before I do anything. Thank God I don't need it. That's the blessing. Yes, sir.
Mayor, I'm told that you were the victim of a snob factor when you applied for membership to the university club. You reasoned with the board, and they went through an agonizing reappraisal. Admitted you. Could you fill us in on that?
Yeah, sure. Back years ago, when I first became mayor, there was a very important person in my life who was a Supreme Court judge. His name was Judge Paolino. He was close to my dad, close to my mother. So he said to me, he was on the Supreme Court, he said, you should join the university club. I said, where's that? It's over on the east side. I said, okay. So I said, well, how do I join? Well, is there an application? No, it's going to be proposed. And you have to sign a letter and all. So I said, fine. So we did it. And I think two Supreme Court justices proposed me. So it's going to take a while now. It's going to take a little while. It's going to take, two, 3 years, a year. I said, oh, okay, fine. So I forgot about it. And four years after this happened, we were cleaning out the files. And my secretary said, what do you want to do with this university club deal? I completely forgot about it. I said, oh, yeah. So I picked up the phone and I called the judge. I said, judge, what about this university club thing? I'm going to throw the file away. No. And he was very hesitant. And I could tell something was wrong. So I called a friend of mine who was on the board there. And I said, well, something doesn't sound right. So I had him come down and he finally admitted I was blackballed. So I said, by whom? And he said, Eddie Morrow. Eddie Morrow was a guy I know why I was blackballed. He was a very close supporter of the guy I beat for mayor. And they had a big contract with the city. I think on piping. You know, they would drop off pipe and had 10% for themselves, and that was it. We ended that. They had to go to bid after that. Anyway, so I think that's why I got blackballed. But maybe a lot of but he's the guy who did it. So I just hung on and didn't do a thing. In 23 years, right?
It's a long wait list.
Yeah. No, I was already blackballed, right? So, but I didn't know it, and they never told me officially. So now, they want to expand the club. And so they applied for 27 or 28 variances, you know. And I didn't interfere. They got all of them except one. And they wanted to put in an elevator that was in a staircase that was not fire rated. I guess for their old, you know, gents, if it was Father's Day, they guess they were in there taking them up and down, and there was a fire. They didn't really care much about them because they didn't want to go for the fire rated wall, right? So I was not involved in it, and the building inspector said no. They went up to the building board of review. And the building inspector said, you can go ahead and do all the other work, but you can't do the work on that fire, on that elevator, because I'm not approving it. So I got a call now from them saying, they thought I was interfering. So they sent me a letter saying they wanted a meeting. So I didn't answer the letter. So they call me. And, I figured that waited 22 years to meet for them. So they finally called, and I gave them an appointment. They said they wanted to have the building inspector in the city, so they all came in the office. And what I didn't like about it, they put bumper stickers on their back of Cianci for mayor and all this stuff. They thought it was a joke. So they said, well, you know, mayor, you can just tell the building inspector to do it. No, I said, it doesn't work that way. You know, I can't do that. So they said, well, you're mad because you weren't in the club. I said, I didn't know that. I haven't received any notification that I wasn't in the club. Right? I said, I've been waiting patiently for 22 years. Right? So they said, they said, we sent you a letter saying requesting this appointment. We didn't get a letter back from you either. I said, well, what does Emily Post say? How long are you supposed to wait to get a letter back? Anyway, they got nasty. They said, well, you're mad because you're not a member. I said, no. They said, we'd like to reconsider and make you a member of the club. I said, look, I don't need another place to go, okay, number one. Number two, I was having fun as mayor. I said, number two, I don't like to go to a place. You know, if I'm going to go to a club, I want to, like, have a cocktail, have a Manhattan or a martini at the end of the day, and I won't be able to do that there. They said, what are you talking about? I said, well, you moved out of the club now while they're renovating it. I said, and now you expanded the club, but you must have had Abbott and Costello as your lawyers because they forgot or didn't apply for renewal on the liquor license. So you can't have the liquor license. So why would I want to go to a club that I can't have a club? They said, this can't be. So I called the head of the liquor board up. I said, he's the one. He said, yeah. I said, They didn't apply. There's only so many licenses in the city, right? So about 2 days later, they come down and they give me this big gold badge and this big. They drop it on my desk saying I'm an honorary member of this club. I said, look, I don't want to be a member. Do you understand that? I'm not a member. Don't put my name down. I tell them that. Leave the office. They go to the hearing. They get refused, okay, by my board. Refused. Now they take an appeal to the state. That's why they're going to overrule the state board, right? The city board, and the state board gives it to them because they half their members were members of the board, and then I get indicted. Ready for this? I get indicted because we didn't take an appeal from the state board to the Supreme Court. I mean, that's asinine. I told them, and that jury was out like not guilty like that. But I can just be sitting in prison. What are you here for? Well, I robbed the New York Central Railroad. What did you do? Oh, I killed three people. What did you do? Well, I tried to get in the university club. You know? I mean, that's the kind of charge it was.
That was yeah. One of the charges.
Yeah, absolutely. Extorting a membership. And by the way, after they gave me the stupid, I never went there. Never once. Not one time.
So we only have a couple more minutes, and then I'll ask you one more question, and then he'll sign some books afterwards.
Sure.
So first of all, thank you for coming. I mean, this is great. Thank you. Just one last question. I mean, you know, you got this book, you've got this story. There's a lot of young people that look to get into politics. They see your life. They see what you went through, the highs and lows.
Yeah.
What kind of advice would you give people who are thinking about going into public service?
Go. Do it. I never regretted one minute of it. I thought you could make a change. You can make a difference. I think that, you know, the one thing people ask me all the time on these shows I go on, all these, what is the biggest contribution you think you made? First of all, I didn't make it. The people with me made it. The city made it. But it isn't building a mall, or we had, like, the first day I got elected, or got inaugurated, the inauguration day, the monkeys escaped from the zoo at Rogers Park. But I didn't know, like, call my attention to the fact that we needed to pay attention out there, right? And so we changed that place to a world-class zoo. I mean, it's certainly a great zoo. And we changed neighborhoods, paid attention to historic preservation, got involved in the arts, in the restaurant industry, convention, did all that. And basically, the one contribution I think I made was raising the self-esteem of the people of the city to levels they never thought they could achieve. They were proud to be part of the city, where before they weren't. And in order to be successful as mayor, there's only five things you gotta do. Don't go off on these other tangents. Number one, make sure the city's safe. Number two, make sure that there's a decent educational system, and that's where we're failing. Number three, make sure that someone's got a house they can live in that's affordable. Number four, make sure they got a job. And number five, make sure there's a great cultural dimension and recreational dimension to a city. If you can do all those things, you'll be successful.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jeff.
Thank you. Thank you.